What are the objectives of this lecture? We'd like to explain the clinical presentation, including the X-ray findings of the Seymour's fracture, and then we're going to outline the management of children presenting with Seymour's fracture. This type of fracture, it would be an injury to the finger, followed by deformity of the finger. As you can see here, the finger will be flexed in the terminal phalanx. There will be pain and swelling, and there will be blood discharge coming from the root of the nail. So this is a close-up view for the injury. If you see here, there is the deformity. The finger is bent at the level of the tip of the finger. There is blood coming from the root of the nail. Why do we see blood coming in oozing? Because this is an open fracture. So this injury is an open fracture because the fracture is communicated to the external environment, which is the nail in this condition. So the blood hematoma at the level of the fracture will keep oozing from this side. So this is the picture for the lateral X-ray of the fingers. So when you order a lateral X-ray, that's what you're going to see. So this injury is actually a Sulter-Harris type 1. Why do you call it Sulter-Harris type 1? Because it happened through the growth plate. Please refer to the general lecture for trauma, and it's going to give you more information about Sulter-Harris injuries. So this is a Sulter-Harris type 1. The injury happened through the growth plate, and then the distal part, which is this distal phalanx, went more dorsally, and it was flexed by the long flexor tendons which run here. So this is another X-ray for a different child presenting with the same injury. If you see this deformity here, the distal part is flexed. Here is the distal part of the fracture. It's also a Sulter-Harris injury. It happened through the growth plate. In this case, part of the metaphysis is still with the proximal epiphysis. So this is Sulter-Harris type 2. Again, this distal part becomes flexed with the long flexor tendons which run here. And if you see, this is a picture for the normal anatomy of the nail. What happened when this part grows dorsally like this, that sometimes the proximal nail fold with the nail matrix becomes entangled in the fracture in between the both ends. So when the deformity happened, and when this part of the fractures goes dorsally and becomes flexed like this, sometimes the proximal nail fold, which lies here, goes in between these two fracture ends. That's why this fracture, if not properly treated, can result in long-term sequelae, can result in nail abnormality, and it can result in long-term deformity of the shape of the finger and the nail. So what is the management for Seymour fracture? First, you have to do debridement in the ER. So use saline and irrigate the wound as much as you can. And then antibiotic prophylaxis. This is extremely important. Remember, these injuries are considered open fracture, so they need antibiotic prophylaxis. So don't forget to give this patient intravenous first generation cephalosporin like cefazolin. If he has an allergy, you can go for clindamycin. And then you have to do an orthopedic consult for the definitive management. So we'll go quickly through what the orthopedic surgeon is going to do. First, the nail plate is removed from the nail bed. And then you do more irrigation. And then if you see here, you can see here is the nail bed, and this is the bone, the distal part of the bone. And if you see the nail fold with the nail matrix is in the fracture. So the nail fold and the nail matrix were removed from the between the fracture end, so we can reduce the fracture. So here is again, this is the frayer put in the fracture, so you can pull the nail fold and the nail matrix from the fracture, reducing the fracture here. And then after the fracture is reduced, the nail plate is put again on the nail bed and sutured to the nail bed. So this is the X-ray again. This is before the reduction is done. You can see how the distal phalanx, the distal part of the distal phalanx is flexed, is displaced. Here after the reduction, it aligns with the epiphysis, and the deformity, the flexion deformity that was present here is now corrected, and the finger is straight. So here is another example for a Seymour fracture. This is a 9-year-old girl, had an injury to the tip of her finger and presenting to the ER. It's so obvious, the deformity here. And you can see, obviously, there is a blood clot and oozing coming from the proximal part of the nail. X-rays is so obvious. You can see it's a Sulter-Harris type 2 injury. Sulter-Harris because it happened through the growth plate. Type 2 because a small part of the metaphysis still attached to the epiphysis. The metaphysis and the diaphysis of the the distal phalanx is flexed by the long flexor tendon, and the proximal part is dorsally displaced. What happens here is, again, as we said, the nail, proximal nail fold and part of the nail matrix goes inside here in the fracture. So this patient was had irrigation, had the antibiotic given to her, and then orthopedic consult was done. In this case, it was done in the surgery was done in the OR. We removed the nail plate, we removed the proximal nail fold and the matrix from the fracture, reduced the fracture, and added one wire for extra stiffness.